Lily Leibowitz, and in today's talk, we'll look at what anxiety is and how it commonly manifests in children and adolescents. We'll talk about the common anxiety disorders and how they're diagnosed, and we'll discuss just how prevalent these problems are in the pediatric population. In some additional talks, we'll discuss cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT, for childhood anxiety disorders, and look at keys to successfully implementing CBT with children suffering from an anxiety disorder. For example, we'll take a look at how to successfully plan and execute exposures with a child suffering from anxiety. In another talk, we'll discuss the role that anxiety can play in the family and the effect that it has on parents. And we'll talk about strategies for parents to successfully support and parent a child suffering from an anxiety disorder. So what is anxiety? Well, the term is used in many ways, but overall, it refers to the response of an individual to any situation or stimulus that they perceive as a threat to themselves. There are four major components to the anxious response: the physiological, emotional, cognitive, and behavioral aspects of anxiety. And all of these are likely to come into play when a child is experiencing an anxious response. The emotion most commonly associated with anxiety is, of course, that of fear. In fact, fear is often used as a synonym for anxiety. But anxiety can also impact other emotions. A child suffering from anxiety is also likely to feel more anger and irritability, perhaps as a manifestation of the fight element in flight or fight. Additionally, anxiety can impede the experience and the expression of positive emotions, such as happiness or enthusiasm, and this contributes to anxiety causing the emotional life of a child being rather bleak. Some of the more dramatic manifestations of anxiety are associated with the physiological symptoms that a child experiences when undergoing anxiety. Children experiencing anxiety will display both acute, short-term physiological signs of arousal, such as increased heart rate, rapid breathing, dizziness, and lightheadedness, but they'll also likely experience and display more chronic and ongoing signs of stress and anxiety, such as recurrent abdominal pain, headaches, and the various impacts of loss of sleep. Another effect that anxiety has on an individual is in shaping thought patterns, and this is the cognitive aspect of anxiety. Children experiencing anxiety will likely have many scary scenarios running through their minds, and they're likely to interpret even relatively neutral cues as signaling threat. Children who are experiencing anxiety are also likely to display a kind of tunnel vision that keeps them narrowly focused on whatever it is that's triggering the anxiety, the onset of a child's phobia. One special kind of phobia is termed separation anxiety disorder, and this describes the child who's filled with fear at separation from caretakers, usually parents. Children suffering from separation anxiety disorder can become very anxious even at very brief separations, such as being in another room from their parents for a few minutes. A child with separation anxiety is likely to imagine all kinds of awful things that could happen to them when the parents are away. For example, being kidnapped or getting hurt. And many children with separation anxiety disorder will focus on negative things that could happen to the parents when they're not next to them. For example, getting into a car accident or just disappearing and never coming back. One other phobia is called social phobia, or sometimes social anxiety disorder. And this refers to a kind of extreme and painful shyness that can cause a child to avoid social interaction. The child with social phobia will usually imagine negative outcomes of social interaction, such as making a fool of themselves by saying something silly or making a mistake and being laughed at. Sometimes the avoidance will focus on specific kinds of social interaction, such as speaking in front of class or talking on the phone, but sometimes it will be a much broader array of interaction that the child avoids, leading to almost complete self-isolation. And although children will expend tremendous amounts of effort in ensuring this isolation, the child with social anxiety disorder doesn't necessarily suffer from a lack of social awareness or even from a real disinterest in social interaction. In fact, many children with social phobia actually fervently wish for friendship and company, even as they avoid social interaction because of their fear of feeling bad if they were to engage with another person. And in this talk, we'll look at the way that a child's anxiety might impact the family system and at some strategies for parents to support their child in overcoming anxiety and facing their fears. It's no surprise that parents of children who experience a lot of anxiety become drawn into the child's difficulty, because after all, people are mammals, and young mammals rely on their parents for both protection and reassurance when they experience anxiety. One helpful way to think of the way a child's anxiety might affect the family dynamic is to think of anxiety as blurring the boundaries between parent and child. For example, parents and children occupy different space, indicating them being two separate individuals, such as when a parent is at work and a child is at school, or when a parent sleeps in one room and a child sleeps in another. But when a child is overly anxious, that space might go away, as when the child needs to be in the same room as the parent all the time, or when a child wants to sleep in the parent's bed. Parents can ask themselves questions such as, are my actions a reflection of my beliefs and goals as an individual and a parent, or am I engaging in actions because of the need to alleviate my child's anxiety? For example, parents of children with obsessive-compulsive disorder often find themselves performing compulsive rituals because otherwise the child feels anxious. For example, repeatedly checking locks on doors because otherwise the child is too afraid to go to sleep. Parents can ask themselves whether their time is managed by themselves or by the child's anxiety disorder, as when a mom needs to take multiple phone calls over the course of the day from an anxious child, or when parents devote endless time to answering reassurance-seeking questions. Even emotions can become entangled between parent and child when a child suffers from an anxiety disorder, so that parents feel swept away by the child's anxiety and reflect their own fear back to the child. In one example, a 7-year-old girl was repeatedly taken to the emergency room at night by her parents because of difficulty breathing stemming from anxiety. Although doctors reassured the parents that the child was physically quite healthy, they were unable to withstand the anxiety of seeing their daughter struggling to breathe. And of course, the child's anxiety was tremendously heightened by the experience of being rushed to the hospital at night. Parents of children with anxiety disorders will often face many dilemmas and ask themselves questions such as, should I give in to this anxiety, or should I demand that my child cope better? Is this real anxiety, or are these just reassurance or attention-seeking behaviors? Is my child just misbehaving? Or even questions such as, who am I allowed to tell about my child's anxiety? In trying to help parents better support their children, it's helpful to address some common misconceptions or traps that parents fall into because of their children's anxiety. And although these misconceptions seem to make sense or appeal to intuition, they can be significant roadblocks to a parent's ability to support their child in overcoming anxiety. One such idea is the thought that anxiety is a dangerous and damaging emotion, and that it's the role of parents to protect their children from experiencing anxiety. In fact, not only is this factually incorrect, as anxiety is a normal and healthy phenomenon which children are well equipped to experience, it's also a very problematic message to the child. It's as if parents are saying to the child, you're not able to cope with anxiety, and so I have to protect you. A child who comes to believe that they're not able to cope with anxiety is almost assured of continuing to suffer from an anxiety disorder until the attitude changes. And so rather, parents should be striving to convey to the child the message, you are able to cope with anxiety. I'm sure that you can deal with this, and I'm going to help you to overcome this problem. Another parental trap that parents will often fall into is the idea that the child's anxiety needs to be kept secret from anyone outside of the immediate nuclear